This is a faithful saying worthy of all acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. And tonight we are continuing our consideration of fundamentals of the faith. Our first 3 weeks we looked at passages that address faith, Christian faith, as a body of truth. Jude tells us to contend earnestly for the faith. Paul says to examine yourselves to see whether or not you are in the faith. And then we also see the unity of the faith in Ephesians. In week four, we looked at we began to unpack the doctrines that make up the doctrines that make up the body of truth that is, in fact, the Christian faith, and we began actually in 1 Timothy chapter 2 in verse 5, where Paul reminds us that there is only one mediator between God and man. So part of the truth that we are to contend for, part of the truth that we are to examine ourselves in light of, and part of the truth that unifies us as a body of Christ is the fact that there is only one mediator. Which presupposes our need for reconciliation. Because if two parties are in agreement, you don't need a mediator. But the reason we need a mediator is because of our fallen condition. And there are not several mediators. There are not even any co-mediators. No one helps us get back to God. Either someone reconciles us to God or we remain unreconciled. So one of the fundamentals of the faith is that the man Christ Jesus, and we make much both of his deity and of his humanity, but one of the fundamental non-negotiable aspects of the Christian faith is the fact that there is only one mediator. And as Jesus himself says, there's only one way to the Father, and that is through the Son. And so if we are not, if our faith is not in the person and work of the Son, then we remain unreconciled with God. And if we are unreconciled before God, then that means we stand in condemnation. Now, tonight, we'll look at another doctrine, and what we're doing is not just going on the particular doctrines as you would find them in our confession of faith, but we're looking at scriptures and how these scriptures have been used as the basis and for proclaiming and putting together this body of truth that is the Christian faith. And so each one of the passages are rich and pregnant with many more thoughts. In other words, it's a lot attached to each of these passages, and the doctrines that they point to are fleshed out more thoroughly throughout, even systematically in some places, in other portions of Scripture. But tonight, the doctrine that we will consider is the fact of Jesus becoming man. Notice what the apostle says in our text, that this is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Now, this again focuses on the person and work of Christ. But let's look at what makes this such a fundamental truth as relates to the faith. And the first thing that you'll notice is something that's implied here. It is a necessary implication, as a matter of fact, something that's implied that is cardinal to our Christian, to the system of faith or the body of truth that is the Christian religion. And that is, it presupposes something. Notice what it says, that Jesus Christ came into the world. And so the first thing to observe here is what is implied. And what is implied, and it's cardinal to our faith, is the pre-existence of Jesus Christ. The pre-existence of Jesus Christ. Notice what Paul says. He came into the world, meaning that he had existence prior to his birth. Prior to the incarnation, there was this person who is the second person of the Trinity, who is, as John has described in John chapter 1, the Word. And then we are told that the Word was made flesh. this preexistence of Christ is not something that you can agree on or disagree on and we can just agree to disagree. No, this is paramount and central to the Christian faith, that Jesus doesn't begin at his birth, but he is preexistent. Now, that being the case, there are three things that support this concept and why it's we'll see why it's central to our Christian faith, the fact of Jesus' preexistence. In the first place, we are reminded of the fact that the preexistence of Jesus means that his coming into the world is an act of condescension. It is an act of condescension. He gave up. Not all. He didn't stop being God, but he gave up some of his prerogatives as deity. He gave up some of his eternal prerogatives in that he who neither slumbers nor sleep condescended to become man and he slept. He who is without any limitations whatsoever, yet when he became flesh and blood, he willingly, consciously confined his presence, his physical presence, to one place. And that's an act of condescension. In fact, John tells us in John chapter 1 that the Word was made flesh. And usually that's one of my favorite preaching places during the Advent season, during as we celebrate Christmas, because the more I study that single statement that the Word was made flesh, I am continuously astounded at how profound that is. You see, many of us, in fact, there are some religions that are based on man becoming God, and that's considered a promotion. Who wouldn't want to be God, right? But yet, look at man. Look at flesh. We get dirty. We've got to clean ourselves up. We age. We get hurt at the slightest things. In fact, not only can we be hurt physically, but we can be hurt emotionally. People can disappoint us. People can lie about us. They can lie to us. All of this. And when you think of deity, he who was before there was, he who existed before there was time, and yet he condescended, he became flesh. Look at flesh. Flesh has a definite starting point and a definite ending point. Flesh can be improved upon. Flesh can also be diminished. We see Adam in the splendor of his glory at creation, but we see Adam in the depths of his depravity after the fall. That's what can happen to flesh. But even if Adam had not sinned, even though he came forth from the hand of his creator, all that a man was supposed to be, there was still room for improvement, either for him to enjoy and or for him to become. And yet, Christ, who is the Alpha and the Omega, he who is perfect in and of himself, became flesh. I mean, that is astounding. It's amazing to me, like I said, how many people and how many religions think that it's a wonderful thing for man to try to become God or God-like. That was, by the way, the temptation in the garden. Part of it was that you'll be like God. Who wouldn't want to be like God? But now we just kind of gloss over the fact that we don't gloss over. We make whole religions around man becoming God, but we gloss over one of the most profound statements in all of Scripture. God became flesh. And so what this statement reminds us of is that, first off, the preexistence of Christ, the God who is eternally blessed, can't be improved upon, can't be diminished. Where are you going to improve God? What is it about God that you could make better? And what is it about him that can become less? Nothing. And yet he became flesh. So what is contained in this statement and why it's cardinal to the faith is that it tells us that our Savior didn't get here 2,000 years ago. No, he is eternal because he was preexistent. And therefore, for him who was eternal to become bound in time and space is an act of condescension. He left his mighty throne in glory and tabernacled with us, which is really what the Greek means when it says that he dwelt among us. He tabernacled with us. But the second thing that this reminds us of, not only does he condescend, but here's something else. It was a willing act. He willingly, I mean, you can understand someone, and the world, the world is full of exploits of reluctant heroes. In fact, most heroes are heroes reluctantly. The people who it's their goal in life to become a hero, they usually mess up a whole lot trying to become a hero. But here's what we get with Jesus. He wasn't pushed into this. Jonah was a great evangelist, wasn't he? He preached, and when he preached, the whole city came to conversion or repentance by believing the word of God. But Jonah was pushed into that. We talk about Moses and going to the burning bush and the Lord commissioning him. Moses had a laundry list of excuses of why somebody else was better suited for it. And I remember hearing the run when I was growing up and preachers would say, yeah, you know, he came down through 40 and two generations. The Lord looked over at when man fell, the Lord looked to Abraham and thought that Abraham would be the one. But then Abraham did this. And you know the rest of it, right? He looked over at Moses, but then Moses did this. He looked over and then all of a sudden, here's the Son of God who turns to his father and says, Lord, Father, give me a body. I'll go. But that's not what the scripture says. See, that's not what the scripture says. His was not an act after the fact. He condescended and he did so willingly and he did so eternally. God never had any designs on Abraham being the savior of the human race. And in a moment, I'll explain why. God never had designs on David being the savior of the human race. But from all eternity, the Son, God the Father, has in his mind, his Son was a sacrifice son even before he got here. Because the scriptures call him the lamb that was slain since before the foundation of the world. Yes, he preexisted. And in his preexistence, he condescended to become like us. But that condescension was a willing act. No one had to force him. He didn't draw the short straw. No. He loved his Father. And he loved those that the Father created in his image. And from all eternity, he willingly came. He willingly took on flesh. And some things, you know, you look at it and say, well, if I had known this, I wouldn't have accepted it. He knew who we were. He knew what he was getting into. And yet, he willingly did it. Brothers and sisters, his preexistence includes not only, and that's what Paul is building on here, not only the fact that he condescended and willingly so, but we also see that it was a necessary act. It was necessary for the preexistent eternal God, the second person of the Godhead, the eternal Son of God. It was necessary for him to condescend. It was necessary for him to willingly take on human flesh. And why was it necessary? One of our great church fathers, Anselm, put it in the form of a question. Cur Deus Homo. Why the God-man? And he goes on to answer. He says, well, because only man needed to be reconciled, but only God could. Only man needs to be saved, but only God could do it, because God promised an eternal condemnation to all of those who were rebellious against his law. And only an eternal being could bear an eternal punishment and give an eternal reward. Do you realize that it was an eternal act that took place on Calvary? Here's what he did. He pays for all of our sins, past, present, and future. But if he is not able to get up from the grave, then we are still dead in our sins. And so therefore, it takes an eternal being to offer in a 33-year life a ransom that is worth all eternity. It was necessary for him to do it. If he didn't do it, then we would not be saved. If the Son did not take on human flesh, if Jesus did not come into the world, then brothers and sisters, pray as we ought, pray as we might, cry as much as we want, get ourselves together, in fact, move to monasteries, and we go from the monastery straight to the pit of hell. It was necessary for God to enter into time and space. It was necessary for one to come in our likeness, but yet with full deity, to bear the weight of the law and to love God's law so much that he says, to do thy will is like meat to me. It was necessary. It was necessary for him in his infancy, in his toddling ages or his toddling stage. It was necessary for one to be a perfect adolescent. It was necessary. Yes, it was a willing act. It was an act of condescension. But when we see Jesus coming into the world, that's why I like the passage in Hebrews 10, which is actually quoting from Psalms 40, that here's what you didn't desire. God didn't create Adam and Eve to offer burnt offerings and sacrifices. It's not what he created them for. He created them to give him eternal and unprovoked praise, to praise him in the very same way that the seraphim praise him. You know why they praise him? Because he's worthy of all praise. But it was necessary for one to come in our likeness, flesh and blood, eternal so that he could bear an eternal punishment. Time bound so that he could represent others who are also time bound. He had to come. He could have appeared as an apparition. He could have just spoken, but that would not have saved. Because what God intended, you know, for every piece of paper I write, whether it's an article or whatever gets to the typist. For every piece of paper that makes it, it's probably three or four that don't. Baskets full of paper that just, I messed up and I got to start all over again. But that's how it is in the flesh. But brothers and sisters, here's what we discover about God. He is stubborn in his purpose. God is not going to erase anything and ball up the piece of paper and start all over again. No, he says, I intended man to praise me. And at the end of human history, guess what's going to be happening? A perfect man, humanity, will be in my presence without spot, without sin, and they will praise me, just like the angels in heaven praise me. Well, how is that possible? The only way that is possible is that another man would enter, would take on human flesh, who is, in human flesh, would come before the Father. Perfect in thought, word, and deed. And then represent those who are guilty, die in their place, take up his life. Notice what Jesus says, no man takes my life. See, only God can speak like that. See, someone said only, he says, he laid down his life like a God. That's what he did. He could only God could lay down his mortal life for a moment and say, if I lay it down, I'm going to pick it up again. And when he picks it up, he picks us up with it. It was necessary for Jesus to endure all that he endured because of the purpose for which he came. Well, that brings us to a second thing here. You see, Paul not only hints at the preexistence of Jesus as being important to our faith and necessary for our salvation. But secondly, this verse concisely and succinctly summarizes the mission of Jesus. It succinctly and very concisely summarizes the mission of Jesus. It's amazing how many people are trying to find out what the mission of the church is. Well, the mission of the church is the mission of Jesus, and the mission of Jesus is the mission of Adam. The purpose of the church is to glorify God and to reflect Him and represent Him as prophet, priest, and king. Adam fell, Jesus succeeded. And so what did He come in the world to do? He came in the world, says Paul, in a very concise way. And this statement is fleshed out in so many other important ancillary doctrines to our salvation. But here's the bottom line mission of Jesus coming into the world. He came into the world to save sinners. Amen. He came into the world to save sinners. He did not come into the world. Well, three things that's implied negatively of what He didn't come to do by that simple statement. If Jesus came into the world to save sinners, then negatively we can infer this. This means that Jesus did not come into the world to transform the culture. Paul didn't say that. He says He came to save sinners. He didn't come to recover the school system. Amen. He didn't come to re-save our political structure. What He came to do was to save sinners. Now, that's just what the scripture says. That He came to save sinners, which means that He didn't come to transform the culture. He left us here as lights. He left us here as witnesses, as He's saving. But trust me, all of the cultural transformation, and you've heard me say this, and I will continue to say it, wherever you are, whatever the Lord has gifted you to do, you are not only here for the good of the local fellowship within the body of Christ, but you are to be witnesses and you are to love your neighbor, whoever your neighbor is, whatever your neighbor is. So don't misunderstand what I'm about to say. But when we start talking about the purpose of the church, you know, we're going to hell in a handbasket. Why? Because, well, we don't have a Christian in this political office, or because they took prayer out of the schools. That's nonsense. All of those things are true, but that's not what's wrong with the world. And that's not what we have been left in this world to do, because all cultural transformation ultimately is just rearranging the furniture on the Titanic. That's all it is. All you're doing is rearranging, because ultimately this too will pass away. He is going to purge, He is going to cleanse it, and He will make it what he intended it to be in the very beginning. Jesus' mission was not to come and transform the world. Notice how the Pharisees always thought, and not just the Pharisees, but a particular sect of the Jewish religious group, the Zealots. When Jesus came preaching, because the kingdom of God is at hand, you know what they thought that meant? They thought that meant an end to the Roman Empire. And so that's why many of them joined along the way. Yes, we've been waiting for someone to get us back in power so we could take Rome back. But no, brothers and sisters, Jesus says, I'm not that kind of king. In fact, that's what He tells Pilate. When Pilate says, are you a king? Jesus says, you know, I'm not going to deny that I'm a king. He says, but listen, I'm not that kind of king. This is child's play right here. You don't understand what's taking place. See, if this were the realm that I came to claim right now, trust me, I've got thousands upon thousands of soldiers that would shut you up. But go on and do what you got to do. You see, I came here to lay down my life. He didn't come to lay down his life to get schools back. He didn't come to lay down his life to cleanse a political party. No, he came to lay down his life to save sinners. Now, that means negatively, if he did not just come to, he didn't come to transform the culture. Here's something else he didn't come to do. He didn't come to make good people better. No, he didn't come. And I think one of the reasons many people are bored with Jesus is because we sold them a bill of goods. We sold them a religion that's supposed to be an emotional pacifier for difficult times. And here we are, they find out that no, that's not what it's here for. So we have to keep on reinventing. The church has to keep on reinventing itself because we created an audience of people who don't like the Savior or his mission. He didn't come to make good people better. No, he didn't. Notice what he does with the rich young ruler. The rich young ruler, and everyone acknowledged that he was a lovable man. In fact, one of the gospel writers says, when he went away, Jesus wept because he loved him. Yeah. Rich young ruler comes and says, good master, what must I do to be saved? Jesus summarizes both tables of the law. Young man says, oh, I've been there, done that, bought the t-shirt and the coffee mug. Not only have I done it, it's child's play. I've done that since I was a kid. It's got to be more than that. See, Jesus does not come to affirm you in your goodness. He does not come to give emotional massages. He came to save sinners. And if he came to save sinners, then that means he didn't come to fix society. See, he's got another issue with society. He's got that. But in his first advent, he came to save sinners. But not only did he not come to make good people better, but if Jesus came to save sinners, that means he didn't come to make salvation possible. Notice what Paul doesn't say. Paul doesn't say that he came, Jesus Christ came into the world to try to save folk. No, he's not a trying kind of savior. And I'm glad about that, by the way. I'm glad. That's what I put all of my eggs in that basket. Because if he ever tried and failed, it might be me that becomes the test, the proof that he tries. But he came to actually save. Brothers and sisters, that's good news. Because we were actually lost. And he actually comes to save. He doesn't try to give, he doesn't come to potentially save. He saves, as the writer in Hebrews says. He is able to save to the uttermost those who come to him by faith. See, Paul tells us, as cardinal to our faith, central to our faith, Paul tells us of the preexistence of Christ. And if Jesus preexisted, then that means he condescended to become like us. And this was a willful act. And it was a necessary act. But Paul also says he came to save sinners. And if he came to save sinners, then that means there's a whole boatload of stuff that he didn't come to do. But the one thing that he did come to do, he actually did it. But that brings us to a third and final thing that I think is central to our faith. And that is, and it's also in the text, when we understand what the Christian faith is all about, part of this body of truth is that we have a proper self-assessment. Proper self-assessment. See, see, notice what Paul says. He says, here's the mission of Jesus. And you can dispute it all day long, and you can take me to all of the homeless shelters. And you know what? God wants us to have compassion on them. But don't tell me that Jesus came to give homeless people shelter, because he didn't. He came to give homeless people who were homeless at a level they don't even understand. As Moses says in the one psalm that is attributed to him, Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place from everlasting to everlasting. And ever since Adam, we've been wandering and homeless. But only in Jesus do we get back home. So no, he didn't come. He didn't come to feed. He didn't come to no, that's not his part. Did he do any of that? Yes. But it was to shed light on what he really came to do. And what he really came to do was to save sinners. But in his mission, we actually get, and I think this is, I don't think you can be a biblical Christian and not understand that Jesus came to save sinners. Now, you can be a lot of things. You can be very religious. You can be well-intended. But I think we need to put some things in black and white. And Jesus either came to save or he didn't. And if he didn't come to save sinners, then this verse is a lie. And if this verse is in the Word of God, then that means God's Word is untrustworthy, because it's a lie. You see the logic there? But I think one other foundational thing that I don't think is possible for us to be a Christian, or certainly to embrace the Christian faith, without a proper self-assessment. Jesus said during the course of his earthly ministry, I didn't come. He says, the physician doesn't come for well folk. And can you imagine? A lot of people said, see, that's why we need to go out. And do you get the irony of what he's saying? He's not saying go into the highways and byways. Yes, there are sinners out there. But he's talking about the sick folk who think they're well. Yeah. I remember a number of years ago, a dear friend of ours was dying of cancer. And she had been diagnosed and it had gone into remission. And when it came back to her, and her time was very limited, and the doctors acknowledged it. And she was telling my wife and I, she says, you know, as I sit around, and she was looking at other people around the church, and she says, I just wonder how many people right now that are sitting here that have a terminal illness and they don't even know it. See, and that's what Jesus is talking to. They say, oh, well, in that case, okay, I'll pay your way for you to go and find those sick folks. They didn't get the fact that he was talking to them. He was talking to the religious leaders. Yeah. Here is the proper self-assessment. It is, brothers and sisters, is right here when Paul says he came into the world to save sinners. Of whom I am chief. That is a powerful and pregnant statement. It's for a number of reasons. But one, it is in the perfect present tense. Paul is not talking about his journey into grace. He's not talking about what he was, you know, that the Lord cleaned him up, took him off of Skid Row and brought him into the house of faith. Paul says, no, he came to die for sinners, to save sinners, of whom I presently am chief. That's in the perfect present tense. That's him saying, right now, what I am, I know who I am. I know what I am. And by the way, I think this is all more proves why Paul in Romans 7 is not talking about himself prior to his conversion. When he talks about when I would do right, evil is always present. Because how does he assess himself before he comes to a knowledge of Christ? Well, we get his self-assessment in Philippians. He says, man, I was a Pharisee of Pharisees, Jew of Jews, concerning the law of God, perfect. And many of us, we look at God's law through a jaundiced eye and see our good behavior being commended. But it's only when God, by his grace, yes, sir, applies the salve of his grace that he allows us to see ourselves for what we are. And when we come to God's law, instead of seeing ourselves being commended, we are condemned. Another thing that's powerful here about this statement that we often lose sight of is that we think, yeah, look at Paul. He's talking about himself. Paul, and I think really a right understanding of the Word of God, and which is part of the, why it's one of the fundamentals of the faith, is because when we read this and we understand it properly, we beat Paul to it. We don't hear Paul talking about Paul. We don't start getting into the salacious details of what it must have been like to be Saul of Tarsus. No, we see, if you ever want to read your name into a verse of the Scriptures, just remove what Paul says about him and apply it to you. You see, I think one of the fundamentals of the faith is that it is only life for those who understand they are condemned. And it is only good news for those who understand how wretched we really are. Do you know that you don't have to rape anyone? You don't have to murder anyone? You don't have to physically steal from anyone in order for this statement to be true. You see, I think one of the fundamentals of the faith is that Jesus is an absolute Savior for those who understand they are absolute sinners. I was listening to an interview with Elise Kilpatrick, with Michael Horton. He did it with her. She wrote a number of books, but one book that she wrote in particular is called Give Them Grace. And in it, she talks about teaching the doctrines of grace to our children so that they would understand the gospel from the earliest possible age. And she tells a story of her daughter, her adult daughter, who has some children. And one of her children, she walked in one day and her oldest son, who was about 4, was just flailing away on his 2-year-old brother. He was just beating the tar out of him. And she came in and she grabbed him and she said, you know, she called him by name and she says, "You're supposed to love your brother." And the one that was beating up his younger brother had tears in his eyes. And he says, "But I can't." And brothers and sisters, that's us. We are the ones to be brought to the knowledge that we can't love our God with all of our heart, soul, and strength. We can't love our neighbor as ourselves. We can't keep his law holy. We can't help but take his name in vain. And it's only when we recognize the can't-ness of our condition that we are able, with open hands, to reach out and say, "Save me, Lord Jesus. Not help me, save me." See, the proper self-assessment is necessary in order to be brought into the faith. For those that they're just looking for an assistance, a boost, a help, a pick-me-up, he'll never be enough. For those like Paul, and I don't know about Paul, but I know about me. If you know that you're not just a little bit of a sinner, but you are the chief, and that there is nothing more repulsive or reprehensible in the sight of pure holiness than you in your sincerity. Brothers and sisters, the only thing left for us to do is to cry out, "Have mercy on me, O God, for I'm a sinner." That's fundamental to the faith, that Jesus had to preexist, that he did come to save, and those that come to him by faith understand how bad they need him. What Jesus gives to the soul can't be acquired anywhere else. The only thing that enables us to lay our head on our pillow with any degree of confidence, knowing what we are, the only thing that enables us to go before the throne of grace with any degree of boldness is to know that Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for reducing the complex issues of religion to certain things that are clear and that are set forth in your holy word. We thank you, Father, we hear so much today about relationship, relationship, relationship. But no, Jesus did not come into the world just in a broad sort of emotional way, give us a right relationship. He came to save sinners. And in saving us, he's put us in a right relationship with you. We pray that we would come to know this truth more and more, that we would embrace it, that we would stand on it, and that it would be our only hope and consolation in the day of judgment.
Yes, sir.
That Jesus indeed, he who was in the beginning with God and who was God, he in whom there was nothing made that was made without him,
nothing.
He in whom all things consist and have their being, was made flesh and entered into the world to save sinners. And we pray that by your grace, we would see ourselves as the one for whom he came to save. Thank you for this word. In Christ's name we do pray. Amen.